This is so good morning and a very happy new year to all. Good morning, Honorable Secretary, Minister of Arts Sciences, Dr. M. Rajivan. Our chief guest today, Dr. V. K. Dadwal, Director, Indian Institute of Space Science and Technology, Thiruvananthapuram. Respected other dignitaries, my colleagues in NSAIS, ladies and gentlemen. The National Center for Arts and Studies, NSAIS, Thiruvananthapuram, welcomes you all to the 7th Foundation Day lecture of the Institute on this happy New Year Day of 2021. The center was founded in the year 1978 by the great visionary Professor C. Karunakaran, who was a Deputy Director General in the Geological Survey of India. It was initially formulated as an autonomous body under the Kerala State Science and Technology Department, and subsequently from 2003, it functioned under Kerala State Council of Science, Technology and Environment of Government of Kerala. During this period, the center was known for its research not only in the state level but also in the national level and beyond. During that period, the focus of the center was on scientific needs of the state, especially in the fields of natural hazard mitigation, rainwater harvesting, and resource management. The Ministry of Arts Sciences recognized the potential of the center and took over its management on 1st January 2014. And consequent to this takeover, the Center for Arts Science Studies, CESS, adopted its present name, National Center for Arts Science Studies, NSAIS. Currently, the center is celebrating its 7th year of existence under the Government of India. The institute continued to pursue some of its important earlier R&D activities and also initiated new programs as instituted by MOES. The vision of the institute is to foster or to excel in solid earth research and its applications. And the mission is to foster multidisciplinary research in emerging areas of solid earth science and provide services by utilizing knowledge of earth science and its applications. Some of the key achievements of NSAIS in the recent past are estimation of important paleopoles and tracing geodynamic positions of India in supercontinental cycle in the very early earth, unraveling of repeated high-grade metamorphism in the Precambrian, documentation of evolution of southwest coast during last glacial maximum, development of reliable video imaging system for monitoring of beach surf zone morphodynamics, integrated island management plan for 10 islands of Lakshadweep, coastal zone management plan for selected districts in Maharashtra as well as the entire state of Kerala. Currently, NSAIS focuses on national network projects, namely submarine groundwater discharge to Bay of Bengal and Arabian Sea, critical zone observatories in different agroclimatic regions of India, among other activities. Establishing high altitude cloud physics observatory and lightning network in South India also forms other important activity of the center. With generous support from the ministry, NSAIS at present hosts a number of sophisticated analytical instruments for geochemical and isotopic analysis of varieties of samples. NSAIS celebrates its Foundation Day under the Ministry of Earth Sciences, holding Foundation Day lectures by eminent scientists. The first Foundation Day lecture was delivered by Dr. Shailesh Naik on 8 January 2016. The second was delivered by Dr. M. Rajivan on 20th January 2017. Subsequently, different lectures were followed celebrating the formation of the institute. Ladies and gentlemen, let us wholeheartedly welcome the Secretary MOES, who is also the President of the Governing Body and Chairman of the Governing Council of NSAIS, for accepting our invitation to preside over today's function. With a highly acclaimed scientific career spanning 3 decades of committed climate research, Honorable Secretary had made an indelible mark on the monsoon prediction research in India. We are fortunate to have him today to preside over this function. I welcome you, sir, on behalf of NSAIS and on my own behalf. Dr. V. K. Dadwal, Director, Indian Institute of Space Science and Technology, Trivandrum, is also a close friend and well-wisher of the Institute. He readily agreed to deliver the Foundation Day lecture, irrespective of the fact that it falls on a New Year Day. We are really honored, sir, to have you here today, and we are keen to listen to your talk on changing landscape of Earth observation data from space and its applications. We welcome you, sir, on this occasion of the Institute's very important day of the year. I welcome all my colleagues in the Institute as well as in the Ministry of Earth Sciences and all those who are watching this function online. Thank you all. Now I request our Honorable Secretary, Dr. M. Rajivan, to deliver the presidential address. Dr. Rajivan.
Yeah. Good morning, all of you. Dr. V.K. Dadwal, Director of IAST, Trivandrum, and Professor Jyothi Ranjan Ray, Dr. T.N. Prakash, Senior Scientist, Dr. Nanda Kumar, and Dr. Padmalal, Dr. Nirjana Sarkar, and all other my colleagues at INSERS, both scientists as well as administration people. And very happy, we wish you all very happy New Year. And we should all celebrate that we have survived 2020. And we are looking for a new, bright 2021. And wish you all the best. And thank you, Professor Ray, for inviting me to be a part of inauguration of,
Foundation Day.
Foundation Day of INSERS. Normally, as secretary, as a tradition of not attending the Foundation Day of any autonomous institutions. But since Dr. Ray has requested, especially because it is on VC video conference, I agreed. Normally, secretary don't attend. But I am happy to be a part of this function today. And as Professor Ray was saying that INSERS has come to the ministry in 2014 from Kerala government. And we should really appreciate the visionary initiative taken by then the Kerala government to start this institute. It was one of the unique institutes in this country at that time. And now also, of course, INSERS has its own uniqueness. And as Professor Ray also was saying that they have initiated many new programs last few years. Some submarine groundwater discharge, critical zone observatory, they are setting up a Munnar cloud observatory, and many more things. And I have taken special care to give you more additional funds to INSERS, so that I knew that INSERS is a growing, it's a new, especially a youngest institute for MOES. So, and you need a lot of encouragement and support from ministry. So I was very particular that you get whatever help you want from our side. So we used to give you a lot of money. And I am very sure last 2-3 years, you have purchased a lot of new instruments and equipment and facilities. And also you have recruited a few, about 8-10 people you have recently recruited. I'm very sure that you will get more and more scientific staff. Some 37 posts are still vacant. So we are still talking to Finance Ministry to ensure that that posts are recovered, revived, because it has gone the 2 years, the quota. After 2 years, we need a Finance Ministry's approval for reviving it. So we are proceeding with them. And once we get it, then you can recruit some more people. I'm very sure that INSERS need more young, especially young scientists. You need to enlarge your vision, enlarge your scope. And I'm happy to see that last 5-6 years after we took over, and INSERS is growing. And probably the growth rate, I think Professor Ray should really increase in terms of more scientific, high quality scientific publications. We don't expect anything from INSERS because you are not a part of any operational system. Unlike INGOIS or IMD, they are all part of operational system. Because as you know that MOES is basically a service department, service ministry. There'll be our research combo. It's not a pure research organization. So, but INSERS is an exception. So INSERS has a lot of freedom to take up any fundamental research. And we will be happy to see your high quality research papers coming out. And whatever new activities you want to start, you can start. I think we have formed a new research advisory committee now. And I think I requested our director to have a first meeting at the earliest and discuss whatever the changes you want, what are the new activities you want to take it up. In the meantime, I know you all know that 2021 onwards, we'll have a new 5-year scheme. And we have started writing the document and we'll be sending it to Finance Ministry to get it approved. And we have earmarked about 120 crore for NSS, 120 crore for next 5 years, in addition to salary and other issues. So 120 crore only for projects. I think that's a good amount. And if any additional amount, we can always give you. But 120 crore is good enough for you to develop any more labs or any buying any equipments or field test equipments, etc. And I think Professor Ray will definitely lead the team very successfully. And I wish you all the best. And especially I request all the NSS scientists to give all support to the director and for his mission as well as for activities, implementing your programs, etc. And as a secretary, I will assure you that we will, from OAS said, we'll give you all support, all kind of support, whether it's a kind of administrative issue or scientific issue or any other technical issue, we all will be there to support you and wish you all the best. Only thing since it has come from Kerala government, you may have to keep a good relation with Kerala government. Still, I understand that they are not very happy that they have left NSS to central government. So they may have their own requirement, etc. Occasionally it will come. So I think you have to give a special consideration to the Kerala government requirement. I understand that for the Varkala cliff experiment, I think NSS is deeply involved, and the beach restoration of some places, and also institute like NCCR Chennai also, and NSS also getting involved. So you please take a special care to cater the needs of Kerala government, that you should take a special care. But as I have been always telling in GCs and RICs and their meetings, NSS has grown to a national institute. So you should have a national perspective also. In addition to taking care of the small requirement of Kerala government, you should think big. You should think big. And you should really plan for a national program. You should be a part of the national scientific activity. You should team up with other big institutions working in a similar area, whether it is CSIR or DST, whatever labs do you have. And you should have good international relationship with the many other institutes, inviting people from outside and asking them to give lecture, the training program. So you should really think very big. The institute should really grow. May not be linearly, should not be linearly, should be exponentially, it should grow next 5 years. And MOS is fully committed to help you. With this, I'll stop here. Wish you all the best once again, and wish you happy new year to all of you. And I should specially thank our good friend, Dr. V.K. Dadwal. I always consider he's a part of the MOS family. I don't consider him, he's an ISRO person, but for me, it's Dr. Dadwal is a MOS family. So thank you, Dr. Dadwal, sir, for agreeing to be a participant.
Society of India 2005, very important one, Hari Om Ashram Prerit, Dr. Vikram Sarabhai's Award for Space Applications by Physical Research Laboratory, Ahmedabad, during 1999. Indian National Remote Sensing Award, ISRS, Dehradun, 1999, and Young Scientist Medal of Indian National Science Academy, New Delhi, 1999. Very illustrious career in this day. With this brief introduction, I welcome Dr. Vinay Kumar Dadwal to deliver the 7th NSS Foundation Day lecture. Thank you, one and all. I request Dadwal to go ahead with the presentation.
Good morning. I would like to wish Happy New Year to all the participating distinguished members. I'd like to thank Dr. Rajivan for accommodating me in the Ministry of Earth Sciences. Today I am a speaker. I would not like to be known as a chief guest because, as he said, I am an internal member. And very happy to see Professor Jyoti and Dr. Prakash. Thank you, Dr. Prakash, for very kind words. And thank you, Professor Jyoti, for spending today's forenoon with me. And I have just put in some random material from a very vast subject called Earth Observation. I would like to build a story of the evolution, challenges, and future. So I only accepted not because I know a great deal, but because it gives me another chance to learn more about remote sensing. I've been learning past 37 years or so, and there is still so much to learn. So I would like to begin. I hope you are able to see the screen.
Yes.
So, ladies and gentlemen, and all the distinguished participants, good morning. Let me try to weave to you some story of the Earth observation data, its variety from space, and applications we will just indicate, it would not be possible to cover. So Earth observation basically in this context is gathering of information about planet Earth's physical, chemical, and biological systems via remote sensing. And what is remote sensing? It is, you know, very peculiarly listed as an art, science, and technology, all the three put together, of obtaining reliable information from non-contact imaging and other sensors about the Earth and its environment, although now we do about other planets also. Also about the objects and processes. That is very important. And you can have the various ways. So when you put a sensor or any other instrument in space, few things, you know, totally get magnified. One is that instrument now has a synoptic global repetitive coverage. Obviously, you can put instruments which can observe the Earth beyond the human eye. And you can choose a various, you know, configurations of spatial resolution, the spectral resolution, the radiometric resolution, and the temporal resolution. Normally, if you were to put, let us say, a thermometer outside, then you could either get a daily temperature or a record of that point. But now here, what you can do is you, through various technology and the orbit, you can change the temporal sampling, the precision, the way it is done, whether it is done through the cloud or optical or microwave, a whole range of possibilities exist. More importantly, through this observation and modeling, you can get physical parameters, let it be the land surface temperature, sea surface temperature. You can measure crop biomass, tree biomass. You can measure the columnar water vapor, carbon dioxide, methane. So a whole range of geophysical parameters can be done. Since you store this data digitally, you always have access to full thematic and retrospective analysis. And since this data is multi-thematic, you see the interaction between observations. So the remote sensing instruments also do multi-parametric retrieval. And obviously, you observe where the humans can't reach. So this makes this whole technique very, very powerful. In fact, you can distinguish an era of what we know about Earth science prior to the remote sensing by satellite and the post-remote sensing satellite. I would like to say that prior to this, a large number of fields were existing. Basically, observation and surveying, human beings have been observing. People were also measuring the time and the location, maybe by starting from sun shadow and maybe by looking at stars. Maps have been existing for quite some time. I'll just cover something about maps. Then when in 19th century, mid-19th century, photography came, then people tried to use cameras on various platforms to do some remote sensing. Then most of the sensors and instruments which observe environment have now been adapted or an alternate created to put it on the satellite because it is so powerful. And you derive global geophysical parameter and then you monitor the Earth. Before we really started putting satellites, the aircrafts and rockets were also used for remote sensing. So this is all the prehistory. So prehistory covers something from 150 to 2000 years, depending upon the type of parameter. But last 60 years have totally transformed the viewing of the Earth. that would be the whole day. I would just like to show by some examples. Obviously, I cannot really cover this vast subject, and nor I would like to bore you with a time duration of more than maybe 50-55 minutes. So, as I was trying to say, maps are known to us for more than 2000 years. Earlier, the map, what you see is a tablet map. It only showed the directions. It never showed the sizes. Then the Ptolemy's Geographia came, where the shapes were trying to be indicated. The first actual map was done by Muhammad al-Idrisi for the King Roger II of Sicily. That really had the direction and relative shape, but it was still not north oriented. It was then followed through various other transformations till the Mercator in 1569 solved the problem of how to put a three-dimensional sphere on flat. So he considered Earth as a cylinder and unrolled it mathematically and then created a two-dimensional map. And from that time onward, there have been survey, including the Great Arc Survey, which almost mapped the entire India and the entire subcontinent. But it took more than 60 years, right? So once the map came, the use of the maps also started, starting from health, for cholera, for the military survey. In fact, before that, the surveys used to be done in King Todormal time for revenue purpose also, right? So the Survey of India did the Great Trigonometric Survey, and the British Ordnance Survey was set up in 1747, and USGS, which now gives most of the global data sets, was itself established in 1879. But all these big organizations were limited by the choice of technique and not the capability to observe the entire Earth. That is something changed. So when the aircraft, after the First World War, between First and Second World War, around 1940s, this is one of the earliest time when the Manhattan Island, New York, was captured by the aerial camera and a mosaic was created. You can see the iconic New York Central Park in the center frame, in the center, with the water body and trees. So the conversion of the aerial photograph into map started, but the Earth is so big, it could never be accomplished. But now satellites do it almost every day. These are another some examples where the cameras were put on pigeon balloons, also on the First World War type of vintage aircraft to do photography. But this could only be done to a limited extent. It only had the military and some other purposes, not really to do the civilian remote sensing and the commercial remote sensing. So in the early phases, when from 1944 onwards, the rocket were launched, the rocket sometimes also had cameras. So you can see the V-213 flight from New Mexico, which had the first image of the Earth. That's around 1946. The first image of the Earth from satellite happened only in 1959 by the sixth mission of the USA Explorer 6. But none of this could really be talked of application-oriented. So application-oriented, it changed from the 4th October 1957. When Sputnik 1, the first man-made satellite, started orbiting the Earth. So once you start orbiting the Earth, you have a capability to monitor. So initially, the monitoring and reconnaissance was done for military application and weather. Later on, you could use various orbits to control the imaging. But slowly, from, let us say, 1960 onward, things changed in communication, computer science, electronics, electro-opticals, development of LIDAR, microwave, photonics, radar, and everything got consumed by the remote sensing technology to become all-encompassing, very, very powerful way of observing the Earth. So, in the initial years, and this was a very, very secret and hidden program, it was only declassified and shared with the public after 2002. So the US Air Force and Army developed this military reconnaissance system called KH, which means keyhole, and they had a large number of missions. But at that time, since the sensor technology was not there, they used to do photography on film, on big rolls. That rolls used to be dropped by a pitch orientation of this huge spacecraft. And then as they were falling down with a parachute, an aircraft with a very long string used to capture this coming down parachute, and by winch they used to bring it in and then develop. So this was can be the only done over some areas for specific strategic purposes. This could really never be classified or categorized as a global Earth observing system, right? But then this happened. It was a huge effort. This picture will roughly show you. This is the seventh generation of keyhole. You can roughly see the size. All you can see the slots, which are for the lenses and for dropping the cartridges, and a picture. The picture is of the Lopnor atomic test site of China. So they had a set of targets which they used to monitor regularly, and they had already got spatial resolution from 1.7 to 7.5 meter. So, but this was never shared with the public or with the scientists or with the civilian and global. That started as cloud and weather observing missions, which I will slightly come to later. So somewhere 1972, starting from mid-60s, somewhere 1972, July 28, when Earth Resources Technology Satellite, ERTS-1, was launched, then it became Landsat. Now from 1957 to now, the number of objects launched, I just checked. This is slightly old. Today morning I checked. It is around 10,058. You can go to UNOSA website. The total satellites are around 5,800 plus. The active number is below 3,000, right? Of that, one third roughly are Earth observation satellites. So that gives you a rough idea of the total objects launched. The objects which are active, rest are just flying scrap, nothing more than that. So only one third of the total launched are active, and of the one third belong to Earth observation. And if you see within that one third, then there are of a great type, optical imaging satellite, radar imaging satellite, infrared, that is for thermal, then hyperspectral, meteorology about 100, earth science satellite, then electronic intelligence, ELIN type, satellites taking videography, other purpose satellite, and there are 37 satellites listed as EO. They will most probably be the military satellite. And if you see these satellite in terms of weight, only 30% are more than 500 kg. And about 40% are below 10 kg. And these 40% have happened in last about 4 to 5 years, most of them. Because anyway, these 10 kg satellites have a very, very small life, maybe 6 months to a year. So thus you can imagine from earlier 57 to now, the entire scenario has changed very, very dramatically. So let us take a look at that. So with that background, we would look at the evolution of civilian remote sensing, the multispectral imaging for thematic and mapping application, which was then followed by the high spatial resolution sensors and cartography, where you can really make a map. Then, because of the cloud and because of day and night imaging, because for other you are dependent only on sun, then microwave became. Then to really capture the 3D, the lidars have become very useful. So this is how the evolution has happened, from multispectral to high spatial resolution to hyperspectral, then microwave, and now lidars. So these are the missions of Landsat starting from 1972. The first three Landsat were scanners, multispectral, broadband, and they were based on a Nimbus platform. In that era, the idea was to make a satellite and put a large suite of sensors. That is, I will just indicate for Nimbus, how many follow-on satellites just had a heritage from Nimbus. Landsat 4 and 5, they had the thematic mapper. You can see the orientation has changed. Thermal band also came. Incidentally, Landsat 5 functioned for close to 29 years, although in a slightly degraded form. Then Landsat 6 and 7 came, and now we have the enlarged Landsat 8. So this Landsat, between 85 to 95, the US government tried to commercialize. It failed. It almost stopped selling. Then by 2007, they said that this is a open data. So it is free and accessible to all. And that totally changed the scenario. I will return to the power of the open data, right? So this is the evolution of a multispectral land observing, and all land applications and water applications was done by Landsat. Even now it continues to be used. So originally it had four bands, what you can see, 1, 2, 3, 4 MSS written, which were green, red, near infrared, right? Then the TM had added two things. One on blue side, plus it added a shortwave infrared 5 and 7, and the channel 6 is the thermal infrared. But with one thermal infrared, you cannot determine the land surface temperature unambiguously because of the water vapor and other effects. That is why the new OLI-1 and OLI-2, both of them have two thermal, and they also have a panchromatic band, and they have a channel 9, which is in the window, atmospheric window, which can detect very thin cirrus cloud. Because this is very important, these thin cirrus cloud, they contaminate the radiometry. So if you can detect them and subtract them, it really makes a lot of difference. So then this table summarizes 40 years, now close to 50 years of the Earth viewing. So you name any application, forest, agriculture, geology, urban mapping, environment monitoring, all have been done by these suite of sensors. Now, as I said, 2006, it was declared open data, but now this has been given a tough time by another European Commission, the constellation, which is called Sentinel. I'll just now come to Sentinel. So here you are talking of resolutions of 30 meter west, one single band of 15 meter panchromatic, and then you are talking thermal of 60 and 100 meter, right? Swath of 185. So now what Sentinel have done is, they have moved to 12 bands. They have added bands at red edge and water vapor and near infrared narrow. So what basically it has done is, you can characterize the functioning of the vegetation, the greening, browning, photosynthesis rate, and large number of biophysical parameters, because wherever the water is there, growing season is there, vegetation will come. Vegetation is one of the dominant signals over the earth, over the land, unless you have desert and rocks, right, or snow. So that is why it characterizes it much better. And the resolutions are 10 meter for imaging, 20 meter for red edge and SWIR, and they have 60 meter for the cirrus cloud and the coastal aerosol. So now on the same platform, now you have three resolution. So now you start working with multi-resolution data, and this data is all open and free. And there are now two Sentinel-2, 2A, 2B. So this whole globe is covered every week, 5 days to be precise, and you can download. So now this is a open invitation for all people with analytics and any application. You already have the Landsat 8 also available. So many days you will be able to get an image within 3 days. Not only the bands have increased, the signal to noise ratio has also changed. So what, if you see the lower panel, I've tried to indicate a comparison with the orthophoto of Sentinel 2A with Spot and Landsat. So Landsat is 30 meter, Spot is 10 meter, and Sentinel is also 10 meter. So it is able to do that small bond and the shadow much better than the other, because it has a better signal to noise ratio. And so the whole idea is one needs to look at the full width, half maxima, and signal to noise to really find how a sensor will perform, right? So it is not the spatial resolution and the temporal resolution alone. So now if you take the applications, this is the entire gamut of applications: geology, topography, land cover, urban growth, climate, water quality, agriculture, urban, disaster response, ocean and coastal water, and weather. Every application has a different requirement for spatial resolution. There it is indicated from centimeter scale to above 20, 50 kilometer. Like climate is 100 kilometer. In the time, it is shown from 1 hour to like twice or thrice in a year, right? That is land cover or urban growth. So if on the top are indicated the bands and the satellite. So since the requirements of the spatial and temporal are so different, the wavelengths used are so different, and then within them, different generation of satellite have different radiometry. So basically, MARIS, if you see a hyperspectral and MODIS, they have 2^12 and 2^16 bit resolution. So basically, you can measure a difference in radiance between 0 and 100% albedo into 65,000 levels. And the earlier one used to have only 2^5 to 8, even if it is 2^8. So we are talking of 0 to 256 levels. So the capability to detect very, very small radiometric differences has also evolved over these 40 years. So this technology, whether it is related to optoelectronics, better design, faster electronics, but parallelly the data sizes have actually exponentially grown. So for land remote sensing, diverse applications, very complex user needs, multiple solutions, all technologies have come together, and there has been a continuous innovation, very large number of satellite, we almost talked to 100 plus satellite and one goal, societal good. But now, since the data is free, more and more commercial opportunities are now coming up for the remote sensing. So how does various properties manifest? So if you really look at it, let us say vegetation, grass or a crop, if you are measuring in the visible, you will get vegetation index, which will be measure of the crop vigor or leaf area index. If you have a narrow channel in the infrared, if it, you are in the solar induced fluorescence, you would actually get the light absorbed, which is emitting as a fluorescence. So you will really measure the photosynthesis rate. If you are viewing the canopy in thermal band, what you will really observe is its temperature. So as the water moves through the canopy, it cools the leaf. So you would really measure the canopy temperature as a function of evapotranspiration. If you use SAR or a radar, depending upon the band X, C or L, it will penetrate differentially. So it will give the top of the canopy or the full canopy, biomass, water volume. In fact, it will give the volume scattering. And if you measure in passive microwave, you will get an optical depth which is determined by the total canopy columnar water content. As from any temperature, you will get the passive microwave emissions, and these emissions will be attenuated by the water present there. So roughly you can see this, depending of now on the wavelength you have chosen or combination of wavelength, depending upon the spatial resolution, your orbit, you can really cover in your desired way any part of the Earth or the whole globe. So now, since 1972, what has happened? Below in the x-axis, the bar is the number of these satellites launched in a year. So now past 2 years, 3 years, the number of satellites getting launched is more than 100. But for the first, let us say 38 years or so, it used to be around less than 10. Secondly, the red line indicates the 3 year spatial resolution. So the initial effort was to have better and better spatial resolution till finally we landed around 20 meters. After that, they moved on to put in more spectral channels, better spectral data, right? Then came the planet flock, which is like a 4 meter, less than 10 kg satellite, which is a 3U CubeSat, which really has changed the entire scenario. And so roughly now, we have gone back to three type of classes of satellite: a free 10 to 30 meter satellite, a environmental monitoring satellite from 300 meter to 1000 meter, and a commercial satellite of better than 10 meter. And one of them is Planet. I will indicate the very high resolution, which is of the centimeter scale also. So this is what has happened. So this is summary of almost 488 Earth observation satellite over this period. Parallelly, another thing happened. So from 2000 onward, so a multinational effort has been to build an international space station. So from 2000 onward, man is continuously present in space, right? 3 to 5 member crew is always there. Now the International Space Station has become really an Earth imaging platform. Because of its orbit, it cannot look above 65 degree north and below 65 degrees south. So only in this band, 65 degree north to 65 degree south, it will image. But then it can do almost a repetitivity of 3 days, and depending upon the swath, etc., you can almost. So the number of Earth science instrument which have been flown So many of them are the first generation proof of concept. Some of them like RapidSCAT, when all the regular missions failed, so very rapidly the RapidSCAT was put. The advantage of this is you only have to build a sensor and send it along with the crew. The crew will do extra vehicular activity and attach it outside in the unpressurized part. There is a power available inside. There are a large number of computer and connectivity. So you don't really have to worry about platform, control, and any other part. If you have a sensor and it has an interface to computer, you can then build it, right? So as of now, dozens of the Earth science instrument have actually flown. So this is another very important change. So you don't really have to build a full autonomous satellite to do Earth observation. So to summarize, the number of launches has exponentially risen because of the small satellite. The small satellites are very cost effective. The planet, which has now more than 300 satellites, covers the entire Earth every day. 14 million images are covered every day. The sensor advancement of digital globe, which is now called Maxar, it covers the entire globe. In fact, it covers almost 1.6 million square kilometer every day at 30 centimeter resolution. Now, the communication power from the space to ground is very, very fast. It is not the earlier era when they used to had to drop the film and then collect it and develop. Now you can do it near real time. Now, because of such a huge data, the use of artificial intelligence and machine learning has really become important. And because of CubeSat, the average weight of the satellite has also come to like 120 kg is put. The 8,440 was the Envisat satellite of the ESA, which really had almost more than a dozen sensors covering entire possibilities of hyperspectral, thermal, and microwave, and altimeter. So now, because if something happens to the platform, the entire thing falls apart. People have, from single to complex, now they have gone back to simpler, miniaturized, less weight, single event stations and satellites, and they are cheaper to launch also with less gestation period, right? So this has been the trend. Parallelly, there have been innovative ways to observe. One is that you are now seeing the very faint light at night, which allows us to see light and fire. You also use the radar for interferometry, where you don't observe the backscatter, you observe the phase difference. So the millimeter scale variation, terrain movements can be seen. Then you control not one satellite, but a group of satellites together, so as a constellation. As I've already mentioned, the International Space Station itself has become a platform. Also, we have now been able to measure the force fields, gravity and magnetic. And for atmosphere, the radio occultation, basically the refraction of the microwave signal from the GPS satellite, has given us atmospheric profile. The reflectometry and use of radio signal from space for moving target and from ground for the atmospheric properties. So now there are various now innovative ways and new powerful methods are continuously being evolved. Now, the optical data had an issue. If there is a cloud, you won't get any information and you will only get once a day. Then radar technology, which was developed during Second World War, from the radar it came SLAR and then SAR. Synthetic aperture radar is you send a signal and you receive it at multiple time as the satellite is moving. So you make antenna which is sort of synthetic, and the longer the antenna, so better is the resolution. So that is why you are able to now go, as of now, to 1 meter. But the radars have been in C band, L band, and X band. X band is more on the surface roughness. L band is able to penetrate the vegetation, more dry soil also, and also give the forest biomass. C, depending upon the roughness and the vegetation density and the incidence angle. It interacts with various parts of the canopy and has been the most commonly used for earth observation. X-band has been used most for the surface and military application because it is more receptive, and C-band also is very sensitive to the dielectric and also gives very good soil moisture properties also. So you can roughly see a whole range of microwave missions have also come. So compared to the other now, the SAR-C and CSAT. SAR-C was on shuttle in 1994. CSAT was in 1978, the earliest. After that, there have been European ERS and NVSAT, Canadian RadarSat, Japanese ELOS, Sentinels are again, and Cosmos SkyMet is the Italian, and TerraSAR and Tandem are giving better than 3 meter digital elevation model X of the entire globe, and they are very powerful, and they are of the order of better than 3 meter, right, for the stereo. Otherwise they can go up to 1 meter for spot mode. So this has been the evolution of the SAR data. But now what is happening is something very, very important. Now the X-band SAR, which is done by the Capella Space Corporation, this satellite is less than 2 feet. I've shown you the first commercial SAR satellite from US. It was launched in November 2018, is 60 centimeter tall. You can see a human being and you can see the Terra SAR of the DLR. So between 1200 kg and 40 kg of this, what it does is it has a deployable antenna, which is sort of compressed. So in space, it opens up to create a 4 meter antenna. And basically, it can really revisit many parts of the Earth in about half an hour. Okay. So you can program it and tilt it and really capture multiple images. That is possible. This will be possible when this entire 36 satellites would have been launched. Okay. So satellites would actually be observing the required part of the Earth in half an hour to 1 hour also. Maybe in another 1 or 2 years down the line. So this is totally a paradigm shift, that from occasional some part of observation to on need basis any part of the globe we can image. These are the pictures of a X-band SAR. They have a resolution of 50 centimeter. So you can see a Singapore refinery, you can see the Dubai, right? Now that roughly talked about observing land and earth and environment. But the weather and meteorology and atmospheric science requires different type, because not only you need to sample vertically the atmosphere, but you need to sample very large-scale phenomena like the clouds, cyclones, and other properties, so properties at the pole. So from the very beginning, I as of now, this is the operational WMO-based global observing system. And what you see are the surface observatories. You can see the surface observatories are not uniformly distributed. They collect data once or twice a day. There is latency variable. Some of them also get shut down also. Ocean is not fully sampled. But this suite of sensors, the GOES, the train sensors, and the geostationary, including the INSAT and the other, they cover the entire globe continuously. And this has totally improved the specifying the current state of the weather and enhanced. Also, all the enhancement of the now casting and weather prediction you see to a major extent has been this data assimilation from the satellite. I will not be covering much, except I thought you could see the first image, that is April 1, 1960 from Tyros 1. At that time, since the detectors and the communication to Earth was of very primitive type, it was like a TV scan, very slow TV scan. The radiometry was not very good, and you would get a picture like this. So the Nimbus satellite, which were the operational early satellite, they covered a large number of parameters of meteorology, water vapor, stratospheric ozone, ocean, the large-scale features of geology, high albedo ice, SST. They also covered the sea surface wind, red NIR ratio for vegetation. They covered from TOFs the atmospheric humidity. They covered the solar radiation. So, in fact, now for each one, from this suite of sensors, which was there on Nimbus 7 in the 70s, you can roughly see how many new, independent, and more enhanced missions have come. Okay, so we have gone from this complex to specialized mission. So if you look at the US geostationary weather monitoring, the first set of satellites, GOES 1 to 3, they were spin stabilized. GOES 4 to 7 from 80s was the vertical profiling. And from 90s, they moved on to the three-axis stabilized. In contrast, the India and INSAT system had been the three-axis stabilized from the early days, although the first one were made by Ford Aerospace. But the recent one, if you really see the most latest of the GOES R series, it has an advanced baseline imager, very high capability. It has a magnetometer. It measures the UV and X-rays. It also measures the entire space environment. So this is a much more capable. It does the earth weather and the space weather and the lightning and takes pictures every 15 minutes. So if it goes east and west, it really covers a very large area on both sides of the US, the oceans, and contributes to the now casting and weather prediction in a very, very significant way. So these are the channels which are specifically for cloud particle size, upper level water, middle level water vapor, the ozone, long wave radiation, green, and also the carbon dioxide. So we will not be able to go into further detail, except to just briefly tell you about the evolution of the INSAT system 1A from 1982. To the INSAT 3D. So it had VHRR of visible and thermal infrared, which then changed to visible water vapor with INSAT 2E. Also the spatial resolution improved. So earlier we were only having the outgoing long wave radiation, cloud motion vector, a quantitative rain precipitation and cloud image. Now you have the upper humidity and much more parameters. And then from inside 3D onward, the Sounder 19 channel sounder was put, which then gives the temperature and humidity profile and ozone. So now this has become the standard, and there will be fourth generation InSAT with hyperspectral sounder, with the microwave based SST and many other, which I'm sure the IMD and ISRO will work together. What has changed now, most recently? I am showing you the earliest image, which is a Doppler wind lidar. So from a lidar in space, perpendicular to the satellite track, this is an image of the 6th May 2020, you are getting the vertical distribution of wind. Now, this data is now available every 3 hours. So this will totally transform the weather prediction, because you will get the vertical. You can see the structure. Something which is just phenomenal has not been available till now. So the other important part, if we leave away the cloud, rain and wind, has been the atmospheric ozone. A very interesting is this atmospheric ozone. This is one example of space where the space measured the globally the levels monthly and even better than that of ozone. Then the entire community signed a Montreal Protocol, and they decided not to further release the dangerous chemicals, which is leading to depletion of ozone. And then subsequently, the improvement or changes in the ozone have been done. So this has been called by some people as a black swan movement, where the Earth observation has been able to respond to a societal need, has collected a scientific data. It has led to agreement and a policy. It has also monitored the policy and its implementation. So this is the way, but the techniques I have just now listed there, you can measure it in UV backscatter above the cloud level, because it is above the ozone. You can measure it as a thermal emission in LIMS, or you can also measure through lidar and various other techniques. So there are multiple ways to measure the ozone. Secondly, you can see a whole range of the missions. And even now, more than half a dozen missions are active. And then in future, there would be even more accurate ozone measurement. So what does it lead to? It leads to measuring of the ozone hole, actual size, duration for which the ozone hole remains, and a very large number of other factors. Something very interesting for the, we talked of sounding, but now there are a large number of the GPS signals, right? So if we see the refraction of these signals, the refractometry, GNSS-RO, we can actually get a radio occultation and compute the profile. So the, while there are few hundreds of radio sounds, but we can cover the entire globe with thousands of profile retrieval through such a technique. Also, once this GPS signal interacts with the ocean and comes back, we could do the reflectometry specifically over ocean and snow, but of course land reflectometry also has a signal. So we can use the free GPS-led signals and their interaction with the atmosphere and the Earth's surface to do more remote sensing and Earth observation. So this is a new technology. More and more missions are being planned and new techniques are being developed for this purpose. COSMIC, of course, is the operational as of now. Now, if you come to now the ocean, we tried to cover land. We did cover atmosphere to a very, very small extent. Ocean is a very vast subject, which has an ocean color, sea surface temperature, sea salinity, and sea level. These are the some of the parameters. There are a host of other. I will not cover every one of them, but let me tell you how remote sensing helps. This is the entire evolution of ocean color sensors from the coastal zone color scanner CZCS 78 to 86, which was on a Nimbus. Then we had the ocean color thermal scanner, the MOS, the CVIFS, which was very, very large, MODIS. Then OCM is the Indian ocean color, and the OCM2, right? And a host of other. The GOCI is the geostationary ocean color imager, GOCI. So one third of the globe, it will see multiple times the ocean color. Also, we had a very, very hyperspectral, almost with 100 bands, put on the International Space Station, that is the HICO. So HICO has been qualified. At some stage, the HICO will also get launched in some mission. Okay, so there will be very, very high quality, hyperspectral ocean color. Ocean color is of very great application. It is for the phytoplankton, it is for algal blooms, it is for sediment. You can use it for the dissolved organic matter, plus the waves, very large number, including the deposition of the dust, the impact of the dust, cyclone caused upwellings, and the impact on the ocean surface. Also use it for potential fishing. So this is a very, very, I would say, essential parameter for. And other than remote sensing, there is no way to do it. So here are the wavelengths and their applications. You can see for the dissolved organic matter, particle sizes, chlorophyll fluorescence, and for atmospheric correction, because the water leaving radiance is very small. 90% is from the atmosphere, 10% is from the water. So the atmospheric correction is a very, very big issue in ocean color. So these are the pictures from the Indian OCM2. Right now, they are working on. You can see this beautiful picture of how the algal blooms, that greenish bloom, are in the Arabian Sea. Okay? This is a February 11, 2017 picture. Such type of information and such detail, it won't really be known by any other way. You can do ocean productivity, ocean primary productivity, and a lot of ocean ecosystem modeling you can do with the ocean color data. The second one is the sea surface temperature. In fact, for weather prediction and many physical oceanography, it is a very, very important parameter, and a very large number of satellite measure the SST, but with various characteristics of the accuracy and spatial resolution. Now there are blended global products. Almost now they run over 30 years, and you can basically download the this normalized sea surface temperature data over the website, right? The next one is the sea level. Sea level is done by radar altimeter. So you can roughly see there is a distribution of coastal tide gauge measurement. But you would only know about the sea level at that coast. You wouldn't really know of the entire ocean surface. This can only be done by radar altimeter. So altimeter, you should very accurately know the position of the satellite. Plus also, you should be able to correct for so many errors. So I have plotted here from this the DLR publication, the accuracy of the sea level, which used to be like goes 30 years, 25 years ago of 100 centimeter. But from JASSM onward, NVSAT and Altica, so past 15 to 20 years, it is below 4 centimeter. So we can measure the mean ocean height of that accuracy, and there would be now a next generation of altimeter, which will be triple beam, and they will even break this 4 centimeter type of a precision level. Another thing very important we set for map was the position. So it comes from two things. Either you have global constellations or regional constellations like IRNSS, right? And you have satellite-based augmentation also. Indian is Gagan. So now roughly you can position yourself better than 5 meter on any part of the globe. Okay. So the status of the navigational satellite system, the GPS, the GLONASS, the BeiDou of China, Galileo of European Union, and NAVIC are listed here. The frequencies, the satellite. Although they say the target is to be better than 20, but what you achieve with the IRNSS plus the Gagan dongle is better than 3 meter actually. And we also discussed this also is a signal to you can get the atmospheric water vapor tropospheric delay also from this signal. You can do remote sensing also, as we said. I think I have run out of my time, but I will just show the gravity. So gravity, there have been magnetic field measurement, Oersted and Chang, and also the gravity and combination of magnetic and gravity. So the GRACE was two satellites following each other and measure the separation. So this roughly shows the panel. If you see, when the two satellites, which are about, each one is around 450 kg, and their distance is being precisely monitored, when it interacts with a heavy mass, the forward satellite is basically pulled. So finally, the distance between the two increases. Now, you measure this by microwave ranging to 1 micrometer, okay, this distance. And then when you are leaving this heavy mass, the pull is there. So basically, the two satellites become close. So as from the normal position, they separate and become closer and they become equal, you really get the gravity field of the mass below. And then this mass has many features of semi-diurnal, diurnal, seasonal, decadal. You can model them at various scales and do corrections to get the gravity. By such techniques, the depth of the Greenland ice, the loss of water over many of the deep water over the Indo-Gangetic plain or other plains has been done, including the flood impact. So this is another very powerful technique, which now has now become stable. It was initially tested. So GRACE had a GRACE follow-on, GOCHE, now the SWARM mission, and it has led to the improved understanding of the gravity. Here, the application of the GRACE in depletion of the Greenland ice mass. You can see the annual cycle, but overall, the total mass decrease of the grace and grace follower is also plotted here. So you can see even for the solid earth, such applications have become very important. I had some more material, specifically the ISRO NASA SAR, which will do interferometry. ISRO is developing S band, NASA is developing L band. It will have an unfurlable 12 meter antenna, which the JPL Jet Propulsion Lab is developing. Maybe 21-22, it will see the launch. And it will really, the earth science application, interferometry and ecosystem, all because this will be another free data as per the NASA policy. I would like to show you this. When 2008, the USGS made the scene free. Now in 12 years, 100 million scenes have been downloaded. 9th March 2020, if you see 100 million scenes. And at one time, the number of scenes sold had come to hundreds, but otherwise it used to be few thousand, 5 to 10,000. So many of the Earth observation satellite done with government money, that is why Sentinel and USGS have decided to make this data as the open data, while the high resolution will be sold by the commercial company. I would like to stop at this moment. Thank you very much. I apologize. I couldn't really enter into the other very interesting part of the future, which basically is how do you integrate cloud? How do you integrate the constellation? How can human control the data acquisition and the new class of high performance CubeSat, including those with artificial intelligence, which will decide whether to take a picture or not. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Dadwal, for such an extremely informative talk. As a token of our appreciation of your valuable time you have spent with us this morning, we would like you to accept a small gift,
which we will send you.
You probably know this kind of thing. It's this metallic mirror.
Yes, this is the very important local technology of polishing the metal to a mirror consistency.
Yes.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. And now I request Dr. Nilanjana Sarkar, my colleague in NSES, to propose a vote of thanks. Nilanjana, you open your mic.
Yeah. A very graceful and warm morning to our most valued guest, our director, my dear colleague, senior scientist, and all other participants gathered to this auspicious event for celebrating NSES Foundation Day. It gives me an immense pleasure to deliver the vote of thanks for the event to all dignitaries assembled here. On the behalf of entire NSES family, I would thank our Honorable Secretary, Dr. M. Rajivan, Ministry of Earth Sciences, Government of India, who honored this function by his presence and inspirational thoughts in his presidential address. I would also like to extend a very hearty vote of thanks to our chief guest, Dr. Vinay Kumar Dadwal, Director, IIST Thiruvananthapuram, for giving us time from his busy schedule to grace this occasion by giving his lecture on changing landscape of Earth observation data from space and its application. Thank you very much, sir, for enlightening us with your work and ideas on this highly interesting and forefront research direction. I would also like to thank our beloved director, Professor Jyotiranjan Ray, for his welcome address on this occasion, as well as for inspiring and leading the whole NSES family to strive towards excellence in our works. I am happy to express a vote of thanks to Dr. T.N. Prakash, Senior Consultant of our Institute, for his presence and graceful words on this occasion. Also, I want to express my heartfelt gratitude to all the guests and listeners present today. Last but not the least, many thanks to our all technical support staff, all the seniors, the colleagues for the complete preparation for this Foundation Day program. You have made the best arrangements for this program. Thank you wholeheartedly, and finally wishing all of you a very happy and prosperous New Year.
Thank you, Dr. Sarkar. Thank you, Namaskar Rajivarji. Thank you, Professor Jyoti. Thank you, Rana.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you for this wonderful function. Okay, sir.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. Have a good day.